Geoscientist Rick Aster was in the news this week criticizing his former employer at the New Mexico Institute of Mining and Technology for a deepening decline in morale among faculty at the school. Mr. Aster is now teaching at Colorado State University, but before he left New Mexico, NMIF correspondent Furhana Afrid sat down with him to talk about his expeditions to the Antarctic and his work studying ice and the profound changes taking place in permafrost, glaciers, and ice caps.
Dr. Rick Aster, thank you for joining us today on New Mexico in
Focus. My pleasure.
You recently gave a talk in Albuquerque about the future of ice. Mm. How important is ice?
Well, ice is obviously important for moderating Earth's climate. It's also extremely important for maintaining habitat for unique parts of the world, the Antarctic and the Arctic in particular. And it's extremely important to human beings because the ongoing melting of ice is a principal contributor to the global rise in sea level that we're seeing today.
You've done so much research on this subject that can you tell us what the state of ice is today?
Well, if you look at the total budget, which of course is a tricky thing to calculate, involves on-ground measurements, satellite measurements, measurements from aircraft, and then a huge budget calculation, it appears that the Earth is losing something like 500 gigatons a year of land-based ice, which is mostly flowing into the ocean, raising sea levels. So the budget is very significantly negative today for the world's ice.
I wanted to pick up on something you talked about some of the regions that are impacted, like southern Florida. Where are we seeing the impacts of the loss of ice on our globe, and what sort of effects are we feeling in those areas?
Well, again, one of the larger components is sea level rise. Another component is in areas of the Earth that have large amounts of frozen ground or permafrost. As the ice there melts, those areas become destabilized in places like Alaska and Siberia. Again, if you wanted to pick out the single thing that is most affecting humanity related to ice loss, it's the global rise in sea level. And 600 million people in the world live within a few meters of sea level. So there's an enormous potentially affected population across the planet.
Could you elaborate more? I mean, in New Mexico, as is in other parts of the world, where one might say, what happens in West Antarctica doesn't necessarily impact me or us. What specific ramifications can we see, or are they taking place already in New Mexico that we should pay attention to?
Well, again, the whole system is linked through the meteorology. So when the situation changes in the Pacific or in Antarctica, when the ocean gets warmer, when sea level rises, it affects all the coastal regions, but it also affects the generation and propagation of storms and storm tracks and precipitation around the world. And it's a very, very complicated, somewhat chaotic system, but we're getting much better at understanding these interconnections. So as the Arctic or the Antarctic get warmer, it can affect global rainfall and other patterns that ultimately come home here in New Mexico.
So much has been discussed about this subject that confuses, I think, a lot of people, and it's frustrating to follow the discussion over climate change and whether people should really take it seriously enough. We have NASA saying there's now more Antarctic sea ice, and the UN says in the last 15 years we've seen less global warming despite record levels of greenhouse gases.
Right.
What's your response to that?
Okay, well, you mentioned two things that are commonly cited as perplexing, and reasonably so. The first is that the level of sea ice around Antarctica is at a temporary high. But sea ice and land-based ice are very different creatures. The sea ice around Antarctica forms in the cold of the winter every year as the ocean freezes, much as it also does in the Arctic Ocean near the North Pole. And it oscillates every year. And in the summer, it basically all melts back, so there's very little left, the Antarctic summer. The formation of ice and the melting of ice on the surface of the ocean does not change sea level. You can actually do this experiment if you were to take a glass of water and put an ice cube in it and look at the level and wait for the ice cube to melt. The level of the water in the glass will not change. So that does not affect sea level. What we really worry about is land-based ice that's been piling up for hundreds of thousands of years in places like Antarctica, flowing into the ocean and melting. And because that glacial ice is grounded well above sea level, that does contribute to global sea rise. So that's the first issue associated with the sea ice. The other point you mentioned is that if you use the one metric that is probably most commonly cited, the average temperature of the Earth at or near its surface, yes, that has, if you look at the basic numbers, seemed to plateau in the last 10 years. But there are two factors here that should be realized are important. The first is that it's a very noisy time series. Because of these various oscillations in the meteorological system, there are, you know, highs and lows throughout the record. So even though there's been this dramatic increase in the later 20th century and into the 21st century, there are lots of ups and downs. So one possibility is that leveling off is at least partially due to these other oscillations. The other factor is that, you know, the heat is being trapped near the surface of the Earth, but it doesn't necessarily have to go into heating the average atmospheric temperature. It's believed that much of it is probably going into the oceans right now and heating the oceans, which we also know are getting warmer. Incidentally, that causes the oceans to thermally expand, just as most things when you heat them will expand, and that is another contributor to global sea level rise. So as the oceans get warmer, the sea level also increases just because the density of the oceans decreases slightly and they expand. So part of the reason for the plateauing in temperature is probably because there's a significant amount of heat going into the oceans at the moment.
Let me ask you, in the history of ice, as you know, and you've talked about, the history of ice has been volatile. You know, we've had heating and cooling periods in the past. How is this any different from those periods?
The difference is that the atmospheric composition is changing very rapidly right now, and it's changing as a result of human activities, primarily due to the burning of fossil fuels. And there's absolutely no doubt that the 30% increase in CO2 just in my lifetime alone is caused by human beings. You can measure the isotopes of the carbon in the atmosphere and show that they're definitely coming from human beings. They're not coming from volcanoes or some other unrecognized source. So we're changing this principal component of the atmosphere. We're altering its thermodynamic properties and how it traps heat near the surface of the Earth on a very rapid time scale. And one reason this is worrying is, as I mentioned, the climate system and the weather system is very complicated. It's what in science we call nonlinear. It's very hard to predict. It has some chaotic elements. And when you change a principal component of the system, as we are doing with CO2, it's like turning a knob on the system that can have all kinds of unexpected outcomes. And we know this when we look at the climate record, because we've seen in the past it has had volatile periods. Conversely, the human race has enjoyed a remarkably stable past 10,000 years in terms of the global climate. If you look at the ice records, if you look at the ocean sediment core records, the Earth's climate has had some fairly large excursions in the past into ice ages, into warm periods, but they probably happened a lot more slowly over time than what we're experiencing now. They were not caused by, you know, the intentional actions of human beings.
Let me ask you about the contributions that we have made towards greenhouse gases. You know, what can we do to get people to be more proactive? I mean, what will it take for people to take this seriously? Because I'm sure you as a researcher, you watching this unfold, what will it take?
Well, I think a lot of people take it seriously. The big problem is finding a politically and technically feasible way to improve the situation that is economically desirable. And you know, we're making some of the first steps in terms of finding alternative energy sources that can move us away from a carbon-based energy economy, which is the principal reason why we're increasing the greenhouse gas content of the atmosphere. And that needs research, that needs economic commitment. Yes, it needs subsidies and encouragement at every level, from the universities through to industry through to the users. We have to find a way to wean the human race off of a carbon-based economy, because, you know, the great worry is that we will not find solutions that are politically and economically and technically feasible, and people will burn up all the fossil fuels. And there are a lot of fossil fuels left on planet Earth. That will almost certainly produce a world that's substantially unrecognizable relative to the world we have today, including one that probably has no ice at all. To solve this problem is going to take a large-scale global effort. So we need to educate our politicians, we need to talk to people in industry, we need to encourage the development of technologies all the way from what we choose to do for a career to what sort of companies perhaps we invest in or encourage to solve this problem on the long scale, because it's going to take at least many, many decades, probably longer, to get on top of this. We're looking at, you know, the large scale changing of the behavior of our atmosphere, and there's a lot of economic and technological inertia in the system because of the way we've developed our global economy and the way we use energy. And so this is a huge thing, and I know it's hard for the individual to get a handle on it, but we need to find ways to leverage the goodwill and the understanding of individuals all the way up to the highest levels of world governments ultimately to solve this problem.
Dr. Aster, I want you to sort of conclude the discussion by asking you about the experiences you've had with some of your students. You've taken them to West Antarctica. Mm-hmm. They've looked at some of these amazing experiences. What has that been like for you?
Well, a trip to Antarctica is a bit like a trip to another planet. I mean, you really are in an otherworldly environment. You're on top of an ice cap that's maybe thousands of meters thick, and it may stretch white all the way to the horizon. It's almost like being on a gigantic frozen ocean. And when you're out there, the students and myself, I think we get a real feel for the enormity of this issue, because we're looking at, again, hundreds of thousands or millions of years of ice accumulating on the continents, and it's hard to believe that such a thing could be partially destabilizable by changing, doubling, tripling, quadrupling the concentration of a gas in the atmosphere. But what we've learned from looking at the geologic and the ice record is that, yes, climate can tip. And even something as immense as one of these enormous ice sheets, you know, that's so awe-inspiring when you're sitting on top of it, those things can destabilize in thousands of years. We've seen it in the records.
Dr. Rick Aster, thank you so much for bringing your expertise and intelligence to discussing a very complicated subject. We really appreciated your time today.
My pleasure. Thank you.